starting. So go ahead.
Good evening, everyone.
Oh, that's nice.
And thank you very much for coming on a high traffic night.
It took me 90 minutes to get here from Brookline, but that's my fault for leaving at 5:30, because I get the worst of it. But it was nice because I could sort of do my prayer rule on the way. And then I'm writing an article for, or doing an interview with Road to Emmaus, this nice magazine of Orthodox culture. I've never heard of it. You should really subscribe. And they come out 4 times a year and they have really wonderful stories usually, but this time they interviewed me. So I'm hoping that, I've been working on that. We just finished at Holy Cross our classes last week, and this week we just are doing the final exams. So today was the last day of finals, so I heard the students from time to time screaming, "I'm free," as I was up in my fourth floor office. I had the window open because it's so hot on the fourth floor. "I'm free," and I heard horns honking as they departed for home, various things, so I was very happy for them. It's so wonderful. I mean, we all have very many wonderful Christmas memories, and I don't want to take up too much time with this kind of preamble, but it's just amazing the kind of stillness in our hearts on Christmas Eve, within that stillness that Christ is really born in us. And what a profound experience that is. In my class of ethics, I have a lecture called "The Face of Christ in the New Testament." And it's sort of places where Christ is hidden in the New Testament. Like the story of the publican and the Pharisee, and the Pharisee's all proud, and the publican is humble. He's been made a criminal, or he's an outcast by his association with the Romans. He won't lift his eyes to heaven. It's really an image of Christ in the grave. Or even the story of the Good Samaritan. We think, well, Christ is the Good Samaritan, but Christ is also the man who fell in among robbers. He's also the victim in the story, and he's the priest and the Pharisee. They just turn away. They offer him nothing. So he's that person who's beat up and bruised. And of course, we all love the Beatitudes, but sometimes we forget. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Those are autobiographical. That's Christ. He's really describing his own character. He's the person who is poor in spirit, who mourns and all those things. And then my favorite one, the story of the widow of Nain, and Christ is entering the town of Nain, and a funeral is coming out, and a widow, her only son, has died. And of course, Christ sees in that his own mother and himself, that he will die, and she will be, she's already a widow, and will be left in that. And so he has that compassion. And here, so many of the kind of hidden places that we find Christ in the New Testament are really there, where around this idea that of his tremendous vulnerability, and just how striking, how open he becomes to us, and how here on Christmas, he's born in an occupied country, and he's on the run from the moment of his birth, and has to escape, and the attempts to kill him, and he's an exile, he's a political refugee. And all these situations that we see in the news, and he lived it, and he lived in his first mistake. He was born in the Holy Lands. So it was a contested place. Alexander the Great conquered the Holy Land. That was one of the things that he was there. And that's why it was Hellenized. And even in Christ's time, there were Greek theaters in Israel, and Greek drama, and all these things. And the Romans took it from the Greeks, and it just on and on. It's always been. Of course, I have in my mind these poor 12 nuns in Ma'lula, Syria, that were kidnapped 2 weeks ago, and we're really praying for them. A lot of people are trying to help them, and we just hope that they're safe. But we're living in a striking time, when the Holy Land itself is being cleansed of Christians after 2,000 years, and the Middle East in general. And it's, time for constant prayer. But Christ said very clearly, seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And the early faith had that, and they did get the Holy Land, right? I mean, Constantine, you know, it became a Christian place. And it was, you know, Christian for 400 years. I mean, it was ruled by Christians until, you know, a series of events that meant that that just wasn't God's will anymore. In any case, on to the talk here, which is materialism and Christmas. People often complain about Christmas or what has become of Christmas. We complain that we are required to give gifts to people we don't know or aren't close to, that gift-giving can become a social expectation and a matter of vain show. We complain that each year the Christmas lights go up earlier, the Christmas sales start earlier, Christmas drinks at Starbucks are pushed before Thanksgiving has even come. We complain that Thanksgiving itself is marred by an orgy of shopping and consumerism in anticipation of Christmas. There's always we cover the fights and things that break out at Walmart and all that. And of course, all of this has more than an element of truth to it. And of course, tonight we're not going to talk about a separate issue about those who, quote unquote, make war on Christmas, or at least just become apoplectic if there's a Christmas creche on public property, or if Christmas carols are sung at an elementary school concert. And then a lot of people get really upset about the Happy Holidays versus Merry Christmas thing. And all these things have a large element of truth. But tonight I just want to focus on the opportunities for spiritual wonder and spiritual progress hidden within the consumerism and materialism of Christmas. So rather than fighting against it, which is also necessary sometimes, I want to work with it. Because I think that if we can get the spirit of Christmas right and teach our children and grandchildren what Christmas is for and how to celebrate it, then those other things will follow, although it may take some time. I always try to start my talks with hope. While I privately do have my doubts about the future, as perhaps we all do, when we come together as a church, as we do tonight, I think we can see things more accurately. And the fact is, there is so much reason for hope in the world. There's so much desire among people everywhere for paradise, for eternal life, for soul healing. There's so much desire for forgiveness and reconciliation, for philanthropy, for beauty, for the truth about ultimate questions, for release from our obsessions and bad habits. There is so much desire for all these things that Christ alone can satisfy. And in fact, I would say that Christ alone and his Orthodox Church can really satisfy these healthy desires. And I believe it is just a matter of time before more and more people of goodwill see this. Our Savior said that the fields were white for the harvest, in other words, perfectly ripe. It was only a question of whether the harvesters would go forth, in other words, the preachers of the gospel. Now, of course, not everyone will listen, and Christ knew this, he foretold this, and he said to his disciples, if they don't listen to you in one village, just go to the next village. And he also said the famous parable that we discussed last month, a seed might fall on many different kinds of earth, but the seed that falls on the good earth will make up for what the seed that was lost, because it will bear so abundantly. Just today, I heard a beautiful holy story that I think you'll like to hear. And it's from one of the grandmothers that came to this country from Constantinople. I think she's with the Lord now. And she came from that holy city there on the Bosporus. And in about 1915, she was a young girl. She was pretty little. And she invited a non-Christian friend of hers to come to church with her. And it was a Sunday. And of course, the Yaya, well, later she became a Yaya. She was 8 or 10 years old. She went and received Holy Communion, and she brought her friend a piece of Adithan, and her friend was not Christian. And the other little girl received the gift with joy, and she took it home, and she left it on a shelf by her bed. For some reason, she didn't eat it. Well, that night when she was sleeping, the non-Orthodox little girl, her father saw a light descending and remaining on the piece of Adithan. He said it was a holy, otherworldly light. And in the morning, the father asked his little daughter where she got that bread. And she was afraid to admit that she had gone to church, the Christian church, since they were not a Christian family. The father said, "Don't worry, I'm not mad. I only want to know because I saw a miraculous light resting on this bread." And the little girl could see in her father's eyes that he was sincere, and she admitted that it was from the Orthodox Christian church. The father went at once with her to meet the priest, and he told the priest the miracle, and he asked, "How can we be Orthodox?" And soon the entire family was catechized and baptized. As I said, this miracle occurred in about the year 1915, so it's less than 100 years ago. And I like to begin with miracles because they're beautiful. And when you see something beautiful, it awakens desire in you, and you start to move. You know, spiritually, I could get kind of frozen and kind of jaded, but when I hear something beautiful, I awake again and I go towards that. When we start with the joy of God's miracles, and these miracles are shining in our lives every day, it's a continuation of the original, "Let there be light." Start with light. These miracles are a theophany, a nice, beautiful Greek word, an appearance of God. Or these miracles are an apocalypse, which we think of as something negative, but it means a revelation of God, an uncovering. Miracles are a revelation of God's own life to the world. And this revelation is happening still today. Meditating upon that fact, upon the many miracles and beautiful saint stories that are still happening, we are filled with grace, and the spiritual struggle becomes much easier. And what a blessing that just 12 years after the repose of Elder Porphyrios, the ecumenical patriarchate itself, kind of pronounced him a saint. And now he's Saint Porphyrios of whatever his official title is. What is it? Kalivitis, the hut dweller, or something like that. And my older brothers had met him and knew him and took my papu to confession with him, which is very funny to me because my papu was a diplomat, very man of the world, the elder. He was so simple and had, you know, 2 years at elementary school. My papu had a doctorate and all that. And these saints are still around us today. We think, oh, if only I had lived in the time of St. Ignatius. Who there are saints in America that are some of the greatest saints in the history of the church. You know, Father Roman Braga, he survived the worst persecution in Romania. He's living in Michigan. Okay, I've never met him. I'm crazy. I should just get in the car and go. To me, to go back to our story from the Yaya in 1915, to me, Christmas is to Pascha the way Antiderón is to Holy Communion. Because it's not yet the whole story, but it's still a miracle sufficient to energize our salvation. And many people in America and the world who cannot receive the Holy Communion or celebrate the Pascha because they're not Orthodox, they can still receive with great reverence the Holy Antiderón of Christmas and its sacred light, blessed bread. Christ is the sacred bread from heaven. He's the manna. Many, many of our brothers and sisters who are not Christians or not Orthodox see in the holy night of Christmas a miraculous light. They see the saving light of Christ. I love Christmas very much. It is one of the 12 great feasts of the church year, of course, so we should all love these feasts. But aren't we lucky that here at Christmas, our whole American society becomes our ally in loving this feast of the church? We invented Christmas. It's an Orthodox feast. Right? We have a simple water. A close friend of mine said when he was a kid, you know, his father was from Greece, and they were living in Denver, Colorado. When his father would go by another church, say a Baptist church, saw a cross on it and say, "Son, you see that cross? That's our cross. And we gave him that cross." See a televangelist on TV preaching from the Bible. "See that Bible? That's our Bible. That's our Orthodox Bible. We gave that to them." Right? We invented the church calendar. Right? Just like we invented the hospital. You know, we went to read that proof. These are our things, right? So part two, materialism. Let's go back to materialism. I want to see if we can find something positive within the materialism of Christmas. some good movement that maybe got clouded that we can energize to become still more good. So let's open this way. If any feast of the church has a right to have a materialistic emphasis, it is Christmas. The whole point of Christmas, the whole celebration, is that Christ is God, and that in him, God takes on flesh. He takes on matter. God becomes matter. He takes on a body. He becomes flesh and blood. God will sit in chairs. He will ride on donkeys. God will wear clothes. He will use soap. He will eat. He will drink food and drink water like we drink wine. He will walk to the synagogue. God will get hungry, thirsty, tired, everything that we experience as part of creation. He will admire flowers. Science and atheism often ridicule religion, and in particular the Christian religion. They say that we're only concerned with an invisible next life, an imaginary next life. While they're all practical, they're trying to do something in this world. They boast in their materialism because they see that each human person is anchored in a material realm. They imagine themselves so practical, and we're so naive. But in fact, science and atheism accept with no qualms that the world will one day end, and 3 billion years, whatever, when the sun burns out. They accept with no qualms that someday the universe will wind down in a whimper, the general entropy known as the heat death of the universe. Scientists and complexity theorists, a special kind of scientists, talk about emergence, things sort of becoming more organized. But in the end, they offer little hope. It is Christianity that is the real defender of materiality, of creation. We alone believe that the most important emergence, human development, is permanent and irreversible. Yes, the heavens and earth will pass away, but in the second coming, there will be a new heavens and a new earth. What that means, I don't know, but I do know that our very bodies will be raised up, restored, perfected, made eternal. We are a material faith, anchored in the goodness of creation and the goodness of matter. You know, just last week, someone I personally knew, one of my spiritual fathers, was unburied after 7 years of being dead in Romania, Father George Calciu. And when they unburied him, he was incorrupt. His body was like the way when he died. His foot looked like his foot, which I kissed in the hospital bed 4 days before he died in Fairfax, Virginia. He was a confessor saint in Romania, arrested by the secret police and tortured. And he denied Christ. They took the 300 top leaders of the Romanian Orthodox Christian youth, and they invented a new whole system of torture. They all denied Christ. It was really, really terrible. I can't read about what happened to them. I read 2 words of it, and I'm not looking at it. But what happened in his case is that he was sent elsewhere in the prison system in Romania, and he was shared a cell with two Orthodox saints, and they completely healed his soul. In 2 years, they completely rebuilt him from just what should have driven a person, just broke them. And so he decided, okay, I'm not going to be a doctor, that was his original plan, I'm going to be a priest, and I'm going to learn all the services of the church by heart, and I'm going to make them rearrest me, and this time I won't deny Christ. That's an old story. It's what we call the new martyrs of the Ottoman yoke. Many of them were like that. They denied Christ, and then they repented of it, and they gained the spiritual strength, and they provoked the Muslims to throw them back into jail, and they were martyred. So Father George Calciu, he did that, except this time, before they could finish him off, the Americans intervened, and they said to Ceausescu, we have a good trade relationship with you, and we want these 50 people released to us. Otherwise, all your aid is cut off, and Ceausescu said, take them, I don't care. So Father George came to America, and here was a saint, and he was given this tiny little, teeny tiny parish there in Bailey's Crossroads, Virginia. That's where I met him, and just lived the rest of his life, every year becoming a little more known in that area for his sanctity. In any case, he died on the feast of the presentation of Theotokos 7 years ago, which would be 2006. And the funeral was in there in Northern Virginia. And hundreds of people came, of course. And then he was flown back to Romania and given a second funeral by the Patriarch of Romania. So they knew him too, and he was buried with the patriarchs in Romania. But not permanently.
Not permanently.
Well, they took him up. They took him up after 7 years, and they saw that he's incorrupt. And it was so funny because I saw the YouTube videos of this. Calciu is spelled C-A-L-C-I-U, if you want to look for it. Or you can go to the John Santodopoulos website, that famous website that has everything. And they were showing the pictures of his incorrupt body on, like, you know, Good Morning Romania, whatever, like, whatever, you know, like, every culture has its own, like, you know, thing, right? And there he was, you know. So that's Father George. There he is. So for Orthodoxy, matter really matters, right? We're the most materialistic, in a way, faith, because of the resurrection. In Christ, God becomes holy and personally subject to the realm of materiality. We remember that in Genesis, God created the world and looked at it and said, hey, it's good. But Christ reminds us, God alone is good. And now, God wraps himself in his own creation and he makes it really, really good. So, God saying that creation is good is like a prophecy of his own incarnation. Someday, God himself will take on a body. Beautiful thing. You know, our bodies can betray us. They get sick and they present us temptations and they're hungry, or someone can threaten us through our body. God took on that body. He made it a holy thing. You know, it's incredible. Christ gives us the gift of himself at Christmas. The wise men respond to him with gifts of their own. And today in our American culture, we have this tradition of unwrapping gifts. Christ was wrapped, he was gift wrapped, in the sense that he was hidden in the centuries of prophecy. On Christmas night, we open this gift. For the first time, we see what a wonderful surprise the Lord has been planning for us all along. All the prophets knew something good was happening. A deliverer was coming. For centuries, they were saying, the Messiah is coming. But they were just handing us the package wrapped. They couldn't see what was in it. What was in it was God himself. The very first hymn of the Four Feasts of Christmas at Vespers the night before December 24th says, let us sound the cymbals. Let us shout aloud in songs. The revelation of Christ is now made manifest. In other words, we're opening the package. The preachings of the prophets have reached their fulfillment. For he of whom they spoke, foretelling his appearance in the flesh to mortal men, is born in a holy cave and is laid as a babe in a manger. As a child, he is wrapped in swaddling clothes. So at Christmas, God's most precious gift to mankind is unwrapped. It is revealed to us and shown to us for the first time. And the Mother of God responds by wrapping him in swaddling clothes. The gift comes at last, and it isn't a terrible Alexander the Great person slaughtering enemies. It's a baby, a divine baby who will grow up to save his people, the entire world. Now this gift is vulnerable because it is a mere baby. It's unprotected in the world, like every new baby, except as the baby's parents and society are able to protect it. And we respond to this vulnerability of the baby by surrounding it with gifts. It's vulnerable, so we surround it with gifts. As its mother surrounds a baby with the gift of her own body and blood in the womb, she's already giving it gifts in the womb, and then she gives it other gifts of her own milk and nursing, and Paniya does that for Christ. She gives him her body and blood in the womb. She gives him her own milk and nursing. She gives him her arms, her breast, her lap, her embrace. All of these are her gifts to the Christ child, so that he may not die and may not suffer, but will instead feel welcome and at home in this world. And so we owe her so much she received this gift first through conception, and then she responded with her own gifts together. Gives us the ultimate thing. It's God giving us his son, and it's his mother giving us her son. You know, at Matthew 25, Christ says, I was hungry and you fed me, I was thirsty, I was naked, I was a stranger, I was sick, I was a prisoner, right? But think how so many of those things, hungry, thirsty, naked, a stranger, those four things at least, that's us from the moment of our conception. It's our mother who fulfills that, Matthew 25, for us. No one else can do that like her. No one else will ever have that significance for us, our own mothers. Right? If they said no to us, we wouldn't exist in this world, but they do. And we're so vulnerable, and they give us everything from their own flesh and blood. Part three, the first Christmas, our first Christmas. This is just how we feel at Christmas. The spiritual feeling of Christmas is so vivid when we were younger. When we are younger, we anticipate, and we plan out our gift giving to our brothers and sisters, to our parents, our aunts, our uncles. We make our little lists and we think and count our little money and we try to. And I think as we get older, we all consciously or unconsciously compare the spirit of Christmas that we have now to the one that so entranced us in childhood. Because when we were little, Christmas was full of wonder. Everything seemed so beautiful and different and magical. And when we were little, Christmas was so full of surprise. We had no idea what was waiting for us under that Christmas tree or what presents might come from family, friends, or extended family. Remember as a kid looking under those gifts in the tree? You know, it was just like, oh my God, I had no idea. Just like, you know, it's like the Rosetta Stone. The ultimate mystery, right? Who cares about the Loch Ness Monster? You know, what's in those gifts? Christmas, when we were little, felt so full of abundance, right? With four or five presents, I felt like the richest man on earth. I felt like a king. I was overwhelmed by the abundance and the food and just the friends and the huge, just that whole spirit of peace. And Christmas, when we were little, always seemed so peaceful and secure. The world stopped in our young minds, just that Christmas Eve night, listening for Santa. Our young hearts were so full of this quiet assurance. And the receiving of many gifts, far from making us spoiled, just strengthened our young psyche, that we were truly loved and truly wanted and truly supported, truly cared for. The abundance made us feel secure so that we could continue to take risks, grow, and learn to care for others, to pass it on. So the question becomes, why isn't Christmas that way anymore for so many of us? Why do we often feel like Christmas is a burden of effort or a crush of worry? And the answer is simple. Now that we are adults, we have forgotten how to be children, too. As Orthodox Christians, we want to grow and become mature. That's our duty. But we also want to become even more pure and more innocent than we were as children. A contemporary Orthodox saint I once saw in a sermon, he said, I was at his monastery in Greece, and he said, progress, he said, is not to reach out for new good things and throw the old good things away. Progress, real progress, is to reach out for the new good things, but also to keep alongside them the former blessings. Right? It's great that we have so many new technologies, but let's not forget our families, our faith. So it is with us. Yes, we progress, we grow up, but we should never lose our childhood, grow old in our spirits. A recent saint of the church, Elder Amphilochios Makris, and I have like a passion, and almost in a negative way. I so want to be present in his canonization in Patmos, the Saint Elder Amphilochios Makris. Of him it was said, Elder Amphilochios reached ripe old age, but his youthful enthusiasm remains unchanged. This is perceptible not only to those who live near him, but even by visitors whom he always challenges, strengthens, and enlivens to live real Christian lives. We see something quite remarkable in Gerunda Amphilochios. While his body is old and worn, the blood of youth runs through his veins. And the saints are like that. They, as they get older, they don't leave behind, they're all ages. There's still children in them, and they're still teenagers in them, and everything. And this is true of this is the way hierarchy works in the church. The bishop, the saints say, the bishop is still a priest, he's still a deacon, he's still a subdeacon, he's still a layman, he's still a catechumen, is the teaching of the church. That's why he's the head of the church, because he has all the stages in himself. And that's how we're meant to be as we mature in the faith, not to leave behind early. Here's a picture of Gerunda Amphilochios Macris, who reposed in 1970, I think April 19th or so, we're very much wishing for his canonization too. I think he has not been canonized, partly because the patriarch knew him personally. So he's delaying a little bit, doesn't want to rush. I canonized my friends, people would say. But he was a saint. So there we have this idea that, notice, our children aren't complaining about Christmas, right? Our grandchildren aren't saying, oh, it's not like it used to be, right? A little four-year-old or five-year-old isn't saying, oh man, Christmas, it's gotten too materialistic, right? They're still enjoying Christmas. They're still living it with all this joy. So if there's a problem with Christmas and with our appreciation of it, it means that we need to somehow focus again, to combine our proper adult seriousness with our childlike purity. Christ said, unless you become as these children, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Right? But St. Paul also showed how childishness, as a spiritual failure to develop, could be something harmful. So to be like children, but we can't be childish in a negative sense. St. Paul said, look, he said, I would like to give you spiritual meat, and I'll give you more a real, more deeper spiritual life, but you're still stuck on spiritual milk. So we don't want to go too far with this analogy. How do we do this at Christmas? Well, when we're children, the beauty, magic, and wonder of Christmas revolved around the decorations, the stories, the surprise of gifts. Now, without losing our appreciation for these, because they're wonderful, we add the beauty of Christ's mother. That we should think about that at Christmas. Let us gaze upon her icon and consider her role in Christmas. Now we add the magic of uncreated grace. Let us cleanse ourselves of every passion that we might receive the Holy Communion on Christmas Eve. Now we add the surprise of how God is working in our lives in new ways, calling us to be his disciples through fresh challenges, bringing new spiritual friends and saints into our lives. Right, that's a beautiful Christmas gift to St. Porphyrius as a saint now. When we were children, the surprise of Christmas centered at the base of the Christmas tree. Oh, we could not imagine what was hidden in those packages. Stare at them though we might. And now, but now, without losing our gratitude for those who have given us gifts out of their own sacrifice and substance, we add this ultimate surprise, the ultimate unmitigated blessing of our Orthodox faith and the Holy Mysteries. Our Christmas tree now is the chalice, it's the altar. And on Christmas Eve, we should be so full of joy that if possible, we would not leave the church at all, just to receive that gift and experience that spirit. When we were children, the abundance of Christmas consisted of presents received. As adults, the abundance of Christmas consists more in the effort and care we spend to get just the right gift for each person in our circle of closest family and friends. The more we give, the more rich we are, said St. John Chrysostom, for only what we give away remains truly ours. And if we give especially to the poor, or to those whom we suspect we may have harmed in any way, the feeling of wealth, which is more than a feeling, but really a certainty, is even much greater. I feel like I'm going longer tonight, forgive me. But I have to tell you a beautiful Christmas story. For a long time I wanted to go to see that, I think I even told this before, but I'll just tell it briefly then, to see the nuns of Mother Teresa in Washington, D.C. when I lived there for my PhD years. I just like Mother Teresa, everyone does. And I said, well, she has an order right here, I mean, a house right here in Washington. So I did it. And one year it was Christmas, and I couldn't go home, and I had a chant at my parish and there. And in any case, I said, I'm going to go. And I went there that morning. And as I was leaving, I remember that Mother Teresa has this nice saying. She says, give until it hurts. And I thought, well, okay, I'll bring this tray of cupcakes, though, a nice person. And I said, well, it doesn't hurt that much. And I saw this, I had this very nice icon from Filotheu. It's just a print of an icon, a Panagia Kiko Filusa, Panagia that Sweet Be Kissing. And my sister-in-law had framed it so nicely that it came with me through all my college and grad school. It was always in my... I said, oh my God, if I give that away, that'll really hurt. So I did. But I hesitated, of course, because I said, you know. Anyway, I hesitated. But then I said, I'm going to hesitate. I think it's from God. He wants me to give this away. And here, I'm going to hesitate when it's a paper icon. God could give me 10,000. So I did. And then when I got to the convent and that morning and I knocked on the door to volunteer and help, I said to the sister I said, this is a gift for the abbess. And she said, okay, she took it. The very strong-minded nuns, not sentimental at all. So right away they put you to work, you know, here's a dustpan. You know, so you're working, so a homeless man in one half, and the other half was a lot of men dying from HIV. So all day you're working, and they're very, very clever, these nuns, right? So they took the volunteers, very clever spiritually, and they said, okay, you're going to put on a skit for the men, the homeless men and the sick men. And anyway, they really made us, I don't know how to put it, I mean, because I don't want it to come across wrong, but we had to make fools of ourselves, but I mean in a good way. Right, so this is how you help the poor, not I'm strong and you're weak, but I will humble myself before you, right? So they're geniuses, right? They know how to do this. So that was a very beautiful experience, and I got home, and actually it was funny because I think I took the train or something to get there in the morning, the metro, but on the way back, one of the volunteers came by, he had a Jaguar, some wealthy Catholic guy was helping them. I got taken home in a Jaguar. I was like, wow. But when I came home, I started to feel very sorry for myself because I said, I spent my whole Christmas day, I didn't see one person that I knew, not a friend, not a family, nothing. So what kind of a Christmas? I felt kind of sad. And I opened my Christmas, well, I had one Christmas present from the people in my parish, I had a couple, but I unwrapped it, and it was a book, a calendar of Orthodox year, something when I unwrapped it, the cover was Panagia Kiko Filusa.
No.
The exact same icon that I gave away. So I really knew it was a miracle experience for me. It was a revelation of God's love for me. And the story gets better because that summer, not at my expense, but at someone else's expense, I was sent to Greece and to the Holy Mountain. And I tried to go anywhere but Filotheu because I'd been there so many times and I wanted some variety, but it was the only one that would take us. And we went there and we sort of, you know, it was Vespers and they took us in and we tried to sit in the back, but the monks came to me and said, no. And then he took me and he put me right in front of the actual icon. So that was 6 months later. And I really understood it was a fulfillment of having been obedient to God's prompting, saying, give away this icon. I can replace it a million times, and there I was before the real thing. When we were children, Christmas seemed so peaceful and secure. Now it can become peaceful and secure as we render everyone we have ever met or even heard of, every living person, all those who have ever lived and are now died, all those yet unborn, we render every single one of them into the protection of Christ in prayer, our enemies and the people trying to kill us and all the rest of it. And we experience a deep peace as we humble ourselves and offer up all of mankind to God in Christ, asking his blessings upon them. The peace we experienced as children on Christmas Eve was nothing less than a foretaste of a kingdom not of this world, right? Right, it's for kids, especially kids in the church, it's not just like, oh, they're little kids and it's pure. They're kids and it's pure, and therefore they're really seeing the uncreated grace of the thing. The peace we experienced as children, I just said, was nothing less than a foretaste of the kingdom not of this world. If we as adults feel that peace leaving us, is it not because we have become more and more attached and in the wrong way to various kingdoms of this world? And don't we also know that this world will flourish exactly in proportion to the number of people who have renounced it, who are living lives of holiness and surmounting every spiritual obstacle because they know this world cannot last, right? The only thing that saves this world, you know, is the leaven of people who really love Christ, because otherwise everyone would just be, it would just be a constant civil war. People would just all be being dishonest and unfaithful and greedy and cruel, and the world will collapse. It's only because people have said, no, this world isn't the main thing. I will suffer, I will sacrifice, I will love, but this world lasts. Right? That's the paradox. Only if we say this world is not important to me can this world become paradise. And it does become paradise when we say that. Isn't it the very passions, in a negative sense of passions, binding us to love this world as a thing in itself, as an idol, that render this world uninhabitable? So let's go to part four, our preparation for Christmas. Last month we hinted at something very ancient, but kind of obscure. And I'll tell you the truth, even most theologians don't really think about this, but it doesn't matter, because it's the ancient way. And it's central to it's central to, I don't want to be too negative because you're filming me, but priests know it, bishops know it, the church knows it, but theologians just don't know it anymore. And this was this old understanding of the world, of how the world was created. And it's this unique understanding of how the world was created that makes Orthodox spiritual life so unique. So this is part four, letter A. But I'll give you a copy, by the way, because you're struggling, you know. Okay. I mean, it's a good ask you see stuff, so I didn't want to stop you. But you can have to take the whole thing. From truth to goodness to beauty and back. You have to sort of remember TGB and back, right? From truth to goodness to beauty and back. That's the crucial thing. Some people try to approach our life beginning with truth and investigating truth. Like, is there really a God? Those kind of things. Just truth about truth. Use logic, analysis, investigation to investigate truth. Other people approach things, they say, they use truth, logic, analysis, investigation, to examine goodness, what we call ethics. Sometimes they combine it. They say, okay, using our logic, we're going to investigate ethics and say, could there really be a God? After all, there's evil in the world. Innocent people suffer. Or could Christianity really be the truth? Because what about people who aren't Christians, right? So they use truth and they investigate goodness. This is the way most ethics and theology get done today. And the third thing we mentioned, beauty, doesn't even count. Beauty is like, what? It doesn't even enter the picture, right? It's like when you go to Zurich, where the Reformation in Switzerland started, and Calvin and Zwingli were both, you know, in the same church there at different times, I guess, or I don't know, whatever. You know, the first thing you realize, there's nothing to see, because the Reformers were great iconoclasts, wanted to ruin everything, every icon, everything beautiful in the church, you know, they get rid of all that. And it was really one of the greatest, although the Reformation may have had a positive side, I'm not totally knocking it, but it was actually one of the greatest crimes against culture in human history. Because north, south, east, and west, they just destroyed everything. Churches and ancient paintings and ancient mosaics and statues and icons and everything beautiful. The whole cultural inheritance of Europe, you know, up in flames. You know? And of course, when the French Revolution happened in 1789, the same thing. They couldn't wait to get their hand on saints, incorrupt saints' relics, and burn them and throw them in the river, and they just, craziness. So beauty, it's out. It's all about truth. And maybe a little ethics. Now, in the Orthodox approach, let me go back. In this scheme, which is how most of ethics and theology gets done today, beauty doesn't even count. It's not just forgotten, it's willfully ignored. The fear is that if you get carried away by beauty, or even by goodness, If you let these things infect truth, then you won't be objective, right? That's what objectivity is. It's like logic with no sense of beauty or goodness in it. But in the Orthodox scheme, this approach just doesn't work. God starts with truth. God versus the world. In other words, the Logos, the Son, he's confirmed as true when the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and rests upon him. So he starts with truth. And then, in this anointing, Christ empties himself for the world. This is how the world is created. He overflows with empathy. Even the world's not even created, and that empathy isn't just his, it's the Father's and the Spirit's. And this results in a theophany, a shining out of beauty into all the world. And Maximus the Confessor says, this is how the world is created. Like, this shining out of God's ultimate beauty was so beautiful that even non-existence, non-being, fell in love with it. And it was so beautiful that it couldn't resist it. It desired it so much that it left itself behind and it raced towards this beauty. And what itself was non-existent. So it left non-being behind it and it came to be, in other words. So this is like, you know, it's kind of cool, spooky cool, but this is our tradition. So non-creation begins with beauty. Creation begins with beauty. It runs to beauty. We call this Eros, E-R-O-S, this love of the beautiful. And when it gets there, or as it gets there, or in the very moment that it starts moving, it discovers that the heart of beauty is Christ in his self-emptying love, Christ crucified, or Christ pouring himself out for the world. And creation imitates this agape. So Eros and agape are the same. I mean, it's the same. And this Eros for Christ fills us with agape for the world. And when we fulfill, in other words, within beauty, in other words, is ultimate goodness. So beauty, within beauty, the heart of beauty is goodness. And when we love beauty and imitate goodness, we become true. We participate in truth. So we always, in Orthodoxy, start theology, we start ethics, we start spiritual ascent, we start our preaching, everything with beauty. Another way to say this is that in spiritual life, we don't take the first step investigating things. The first step is God's. He comes to us. He reveals himself. And then we respond to that beauty. So now this is part 4, letter B, preparation for Christmas. How do we begin with beauty and what in our spiritual life? Well, how do we begin with beauty? Fasting. When we fast, we cleanse our spiritual senses. So we're not seeing things in a distorted way, but we're seeing food and all of creation in a clear way. We're seeing its true beauty. How do we begin with beauty? By focusing on authentic beauty on Christ. We begin with beauty by not judging according to outward superficial standards of prettiness. So beauty doesn't mean, oh, it has to look whatever. Oh, this person had a flaw, I can't tolerate them. No, it means we see true beauty. If our Eros has become perverted, then we cleanse it by increasing our Eros for Christ, the true aim of our Eros. Another way to begin with beauty is to respect spiritual feeling, because sometimes you can't see visibly the beautiful thing, but it prompts your heart. Like, to me, it didn't seem beautiful initially when God revealed to my heart, give this icon away. It didn't seem beautiful at all, or pretty. It seemed pretty miserable to me. But the spiritual feeling told me I was in the presence of theophany. I had to do it. When we begin with beauty, when we fulfill Eros, this total desire, right? The best expression of Eros is, that's in Greek, but it comes from Christ. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. That's Eros. Okay, that's beginning with beauty. Now, at the heart of beauty, we find goodness, Christ self-emptying. How do we continue with goodness? Well, fasting was beauty. This one is almsgiving, because it cleanses our sense, our contemplative sense,
about what's good. We ponder that at the heart of authentic beauty is Christ and his self-emptying. We give alms, we imitate this self-emptying, we employ all our reason to do so in the right way. Right? It can be, you know, if we give the wrong gift in the wrong time, you know, it's worse than nothing. We try, as we give alms in a proper way, we don't necessarily always take away another person's pain, but we at least show solidarity with those who suffer, right? If every time our child, you know, had a difficulty, we rush in and fix it for him, that's not true agape, right? Because crucifixion is part of life. So we suffer with them, help them to endure and get up. We cure our worldly agape by imitating Christ's agape. We love others for their own sake, not to please ourselves. As the prayer says, Lord, let me act firmly and wisely without embittering or embarrassing others. That great prayer from, I think it's Metropolitan Philaret of Moscow. Help me, Lord, to act firmly and wisely without embittering and embarrassing others. And this is the second of the two great commandments. The first commandment is to Eros, the second one is to agape. Love your neighbor as yourself. And in Christ, those two things become one. Because he's our neighbor, and he's our God. When you love Christ, you get two for the price of one. Right? You're doing them both. But really, anytime you love your neighbor, because they're an icon of Christ, because God wants you to do that, you're also fulfilling Eros. So that was the first step. Beauty was fasting. Goodness is almsgiving. How do we arrive at truth? The one who has fulfilled Eros and Agape will be true. So your first concern isn't to know truth like, oh, the truth about God's in this book, but it's to be true. It's to be authentic, honest, be who you are, who God made you to be. You be true. And that happens when you become joined to Christ, who is truth. Now, there is truth about things and all that too. Truth is not primarily truth about things, though. Truth is primarily genuineness. So be exactly who you are. Right? Just be who you are. When we arrive at truth, the freedom of Eros, that wild self-abandonment, and the constraint of agape, that trying to help others, are joined. We are true when we couldn't be false, even if we tried. We have no more choice. We can't be false. We have to be free, right? It's like this is a paradox. And we arrive at our personal share in Christ and the Logos and our particular Logos. And of course, here's where we talk about prayer. Now, prayer is all along, but at this stage, prayer is perfected, right? The theologians of the church, they were like that. That's why they could just say. So that brings us to part four of our little talk tonight, gifts at Christmas. If we have Eros for Christ, sooner or immediately we will have agape for our brethren. There's no way around it. And gifts at Christmas fall under this category of agape. They're an act of goodness. Many times they are a kind of almsgiving, a help to the poor. Ask your child before he opens his Christmas presents if he would be poor if he didn't get to open those, and so he would be the poorest man on earth. And gifts always can have this function of reconciliation. Giving gifts, we aim for a deeper communion with one another. Our culture is not a gift culture. Our culture is mostly a merchant culture. But like in the Middle East, right, it's still a gift culture. I saw this just amazing sequence in a movie called Gunner Palace, a documentary about our soldiers in Baghdad. And one night they knocked down the door of this man's home to arrest him. They wanted him on, I don't know what charge. He wasn't there. So they left empty-handed, and you know what this guy did? He did go on the run. He's just completely Middle East. He just came the next day straight to, they were trying to arrest him. They came with guns and broke down his doors. He just came straight to their headquarters with a big covered tray of rice pilaf. Wait, is that Middle Eastern or what? Right? You have an enemy, you have a problem with me, let me give you a gift. Let's talk about it. It's gift-giving is it's the way you reconcile, right? Someone hurts you, instead of reacting,
I'll give you a gift. No, let's talk. What happened? Right? It's an amazing way to disarm.
So they threw him in jail on a full stomach, then.
You know, no, because he can't, he cooperated, they couldn't arrest him at that point. They held him for a couple days and let him go. I mean, it was a nothing. But he won. He won that battle. They had all the power, and he had Rice Pilaf, but he won. Because he knew the ancient law of the gift. Now, our culture is not a gifts culture. It's a Calvinist acquisition culture. So it's hard for us to understand what gifts are, right? Oh, I should work for it. Our whole life is a gift, but we don't want to give a gift. In his wonderful book, The Gift, right? For St. Dionysius the Areopagite, you know, our earliest kind of cosmologist, you know, all of creation is just giving and receiving. That's all it is. It's just one gift. That's the whole structure of existence. In his wonderful book, The Gift, Lewis Hyde writes that the rules of the gift are three. We must give gifts, we must accept gifts, and when we accept gifts, we must pay them forward. And that's where abundance comes from. It's from not interrupting the chain of gifts. Right? Everything breaks down. Like, when you investigate the gift and you count it, when you hold on to it, the whole thing breaks. And there are so many fables in every culture about this. And an Irish one that Lewis Hyde relates is, a guy is given a gift of this cask of ale and never runs out. Right? Every time he turns it on, it's there, it's there, it's there. But one day he finally gets curious and he looks inside, it's all cobwebs. And after that, there's no more ale. Right? It's a notion that we have to, in addition to our merchant lives and our government lives, we also live in this other economy of just giving, where we don't really count, we just give. Now, we're not going to see, we're not expecting anything back, and we're not looking too closely at what's given. We just accept it and keep that circulation happening. So the gift is primary in any economic life, and it's primary in our financial life. Now, capitalism, our dear capitalism, it imagines that it resolves this injunction to give gifts completely when a profit is given back as reinvestment, right? Because after all, right, Warren Buffett, he's the richest man in America, or second richest, whatever. He doesn't live in a palace. He lives in a home humbler than mine. His salary is lower than his secretary's, right? He's the richest man because everything he receives is just reinvested into the company. So in capitalism, it's like, yeah, we're a gift economy, but in the end, it's under his name, right? And socialism imagines that it resolves this injunction to give gifts completely when it takes other people's stuff and gives it out as a gift. Now, I'm trying to, you know, humiliate capitalism and socialism in your mind just because I just wanted you to know that those two economies, a government command economy and a market economy, are necessary, and the church accepts that. But this third economy of the gift is more important, and it makes others, prevents the others from killing each other, first of all, because they hate each other, and it reconciles them, and it also prevents either one from just becoming totally destructive, right? Keep that spirit of the gift going. So that's our politics. We like both parties, but we're something extra, right? That's orthodox politics. And just love whichever party you like, it doesn't matter. Just have to show grace towards the other side too, a little bit. So in the church, we accept both of these other economies. They're partial gift economies, but they're economies of this world. But we have the pure gift economy. We have the economia of Christ, which is all giving his life for us, counting nothing. And Christ showed, give back of your own substance, not something you tax from someone else, to those who can't give back at all, not someone who's going to pay you back with interest. Right? Those kind of economies, I said, are also blessed, but the church is something more. It's we're going to give especially to the person who cannot repay. And Christ says, what profit is to you? You lend to someone who's going to give back. You want profit? Lend to someone who isn't going to give back. He's very clear on that, right? So the giving of gifts at Christmas is best aimed at those who cannot give back to us, our children. Father, you know, this is all, basically your boys paid me to write this Christmas sermon this way. It's all aimed at you, you know. Because I just want them to be. So
who cannot give that? Because really it is children, grandchildren, the poor. It's people who are on fixed income or shut in. Or anytime we can give anonymously, these are the best kind of gifts. They bring us the most abundance. Right? It's just a wonderful thing at Christmas, you know. So just... Now, Christmas gift giving can also be an essential way of binding us closer to those whom we love when we get just the right gift or a gift of our own substance. Like someone said, what we should give more gifts than we make. And since people need things anyway, this is my final point about gifts, really, and I'm almost done, I promise. Since people need things anyway, they actually do, like, you know, when I was a kid, I needed new clothes every year or whatever. If you supply those needs through gift giving at Christmas, then you're giving the credit to God also. Right? It's in Christ's honor.
Well, he's getting a lot of credit from me.
Good for you. And we show that the gift is not only from us, but it is from God, from Christ, from his mother. Right? So in honor of him, we give these gifts. And we begin to see that our life consists mostly of gifts, right? Right? I mean, you know, like we believe in synergy. Like, you know, we have to cooperate with God. But it's mostly God. You know, it's 99.9% him. Of course, if you don't do your point one, then you're out. But it's mostly God, right? Well, it's the same. Most of your success in life is luck. I'm not saying that I work as hard as a person who's rich, because I really don't. So I'm not taking away anything from them, because that 0.1% they've done to an incredible degree. I'm not. But the fact is, right, most of life is luck. And, right, and you were born in a country at peace, and, you know, with a functioning legal system, and a functioning banking system, and, you know, right. There's 7 billion people in the world, right? 300 million are Orthodox Christians, right? Do the math. That's not even 5%, right? That's, I don't know what that is, 4%. If you're an Orthodox Christian, baptized and chrismated and able to receive Holy Communion, right, you're in the top 1%. You are the 1% that everyone else hates. You are, right, the 99, stick it to the Orthodox. You are the 1%, right? You won the lottery. So now, what are you going to do with that? Well, you know, I told my students that. I said, you know, what are you going to do with that? You know, well, step one, nothing. Step two, criticize other people in the church. Step three, complain. You know, that's what we should do, right? But really, you won the lottery. The question is, you know, are you ever going to cash in that ticket or not? Right? Let's close with just one thought about materialism, the ostensible topic of tonight's lecture. You know, matter, it can be an idol, and we frequently make an idol out of it, but it can also be an icon. As an idol, we look at it, we worship it, we're enclosed in this world. When it's an icon, it's a gift from above. It's disclosing to us the other world. It's a revelation. What's the difference? When the thing serves the person, then it's an icon. When the thing enslaves the person, then it's an idol. When the thing serves and reveals the Trinity, the Holy Trinity of three persons, then it's an icon. When the thing severs our eros, our love, from the Holy Trinity, when it cuts us off, then it's an idol. So that's the question about a gift or anything materially at Christmas. Does it serve? In other words, does it liturgically minister? Or does it sever? Does it cut us off, expelling us from paradise? Well, that's it, Father. My check from your boys is in the mail. I'm very pro Christmas gift giving, but of course, in the right spirit and the right memory of how much we owe God. I think I went nice and long today, so I'll stop. Bye.
Actually, it was beautiful.